I want to welcome you to this, our seventh lesson on principles of leadership. This will be our next to the last session, one more to go. Last week, we talked about the principle of people development. We didn't quite finish with our lessons, so we'll pick up where we left off the last time, and then we'll move in to the study of our principle for today, which will be the principle of vision. And what I would like to share with you in conclusion of last week's lesson concerning the principle of people development are some people development principles. These are some general principles which will pretty much summarize what we had talked about last week. The first principle that we want to look at concerning people development is that people development takes time. Andrew Carnegie was at one time considered the wealthiest man in America. He came to America from Scotland and became the largest manufacturer of steel in the world. At one time, he had 43 millionaires working for him. Someone asked him the question one day, how were you able to get that many millionaires to come to work for you? Or how were you able to hire 43 millionaires? His response was that I didn't hire 43 millionaires. These men became millionaires as the result of being associated with the steel industry. The question was further asked, well, how do you go about developing men? Carnegie replied that men are developed the same way that gold is mined. When gold is mined, several tons of dirt have to be retrieved in order to get 1 ounce of gold. But when you go into the mine, you don't look for dirt, you look for the gold. The same thing is true in the development and training of people. The second skill that we want to consider, people skills are essential for success. People skills are essential for success. I think probably now more than ever before, corporations are looking for those who can relate to people. People skills are so tremendously important as we move into the technological age and the information age. Again, Andrew Carnegie at one time paid Charles Schwab a salary of $1 million a year simply because Schwab got along with people. When chief executives of corporations are asked what one single characteristic is most needed by those in leadership, invariably the response is the ability to work with other people. Teddy Roosevelt said, the most important single ingredient to the formula of success is knowing how to get along with people. John Rockefeller stated that he would pay more for the ability to deal with people than any other ability under the sun. A survey was taken by the Center for Creative Leadership. In a study of 105 successful executives, they discovered the following. Successful executives admitted their mistakes and accepted the consequences rather than trying to assess the blame on others. The second finding, they were able to get along with a wide variety of people. Third finding, they had strong interpersonal skills, being sensitive to others, and possessing tact. The fourth finding, they were calm and confident rather than moody and volatile. So successful people are associated with people skills. On the other hand, a person who is abrasive, sarcastic, aloof, or unpredictable is most likely going to be an unsuccessful executive. The worst fault is insensitivity to other people. John Ralston, who was a former coach for the Denver Broncos, responded to the question why that he had left the team. He said, "I left because of illness and fatigue. The fans were sick and tired of me." A third principle is that in order to be an effective people developer, you should be a model that others can follow. People are going to be more convinced through modeling or through observation than they will through argument. The story is given about Benjamin Franklin, who was trying to convince another person of the value of plaster as fertilizer. He said that if you spread plaster over a field, things will grow better. Well, it didn't make any difference how much he tried to convince this person. It was to no avail. This individual just absolutely refused to believe that that was possible. So Benjamin Franklin goes out and he plants, he planted a grain in a field, and he put plaster down in the letters that spelled out the sentence, "This has been plastered," and when the grain came up, those letters stood out greener than any of the others, and it was very observable that that the plaster indeed was fertilizer. So this was a case where observation and demonstration was more effective than just vocalization. A fourth principle: an effective, successful leader leads others by looking through their eyes. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow said, "We judge ourselves by what we feel capable of doing, while others judge us by what we have already done." In other words, only we know what we feel inside and what we believe that we're capable of, and therefore we judge ourselves according to what we believe that we're capable of, and other people really have nothing else to go on except history. I think that it was our bishop who said that we judge others by our intentions, because only we know the intent of our hearts. We judge ourselves by our intentions, but we judge others by their actions. You know, the interesting thing about people is that people have their own agenda and perception of things. Everybody has their story to tell. Everybody has their visions of grandeur, and they have this perception that their problems are bigger than anybody else's. Their children are the smartest. Their jokes are the funniest, and their faults ought to be overlooked. Let me share a very amusing story that was given in our textbook. After World War II, a general and a young lieutenant boarded a train in England. They were seated across from two women, a beautiful young lady and her grandmother. The train goes through a tunnel that makes everything dark for a minute or so, and the only thing that could be heard in the darkness was a kiss and a slap. Everybody on the train had their perception of what had actually happened. The young lady thought to herself, "I'm flattered that the lieutenant kissed me, but I'm terribly embarrassed that grandmother hit him." The grandmother thought, "I'm aggravated that that young man kissed my granddaughter, but I'm proud she had the courage to retaliate." The general sat there thinking to himself, "My lieutenant showed a lot of guts in kissing that girl, but why did she slap me?" Only the lieutenant knew what actually had happened. In that brief moment of darkness, he had the opportunity to kiss a pretty girl and slap his general. So everybody has their perception. Anytime anything happens, everybody has their interpretation or their perception. A fifth principle, leaders must care for people before they can develop them. This gets back to the adage that people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. The most effective leadership is found where there's a relationship between the leader and those who follow. Otherwise, the only basis for another individual following that leader would be based on position or ascribed power. A sixth principle is that people developers look for opportunities to build up people. This, of course, ties in with relating to other people, having a relationship for leaders to develop a respect, for a follower to respect and to be loyal to the leader. So a very effective, an effective leader and successful leader is going to look for every opportunity to build up others. There are some people who have a general tendency to want to belittle others, to put others down, and to steal other people's thunder. This is what we call stealing someone's ego food. Now, what do we mean by ego food? Everybody has the need to feel like that they contribute. They have to have a feeling that they count, that what they have accomplished is something that is of value, that is worthwhile. Everybody needs stroking. Everybody needs a pat on the back. A person who says that they don't need the affirmation of others is probably, well, first of all, is either getting plenty of strokes or they're just simply lying, because everybody desires to have affirmation and to be stroked. Now, here's an example of a leader taking the thunder away from another person, or to steal the steam from their steamboat. A person says, I've really had a busy day. The leader may say something like this: you had a busy day. You should see all the work piled on my desk and I can't even get to it. Or another person says, I finally finished that project I've been working on for 8 months. And so the insensitive leader comes back and says, yeah, Jim finally finished that big project he's been working on too. In other words, not giving that person the opportunity to revel in their accomplishments. Always coming up with someone else who has either done it or done it better. What a leader is actually saying in such a situation: you may think you're pretty good, but let me tell you about someone else who is probably better. You might want to try this experiment. Maybe beginning tomorrow. Check yourself. See how many times you catch yourself satisfying your own esteem needs by stealing someone else's ego food. Let me give you very quickly, and this is all under the principle of developers looking for opportunities to build up other people. Let me share with you some sub-principles. Principles which cause workers to be uneasy, or that creates unrest among workers. One is the failure of superiors or supervisors to give credit for suggestions. Number two is the failure on the part of leaders to correct grievances. Number three, the failure to encourage. Number four, criticizing employees in front of other people. Number five, failure to ask employees their opinions. Number six, failure to inform employees of their progress, and number seven, favoritism. All right, let's go back and take a look at these and give you an opportunity to write these down. Failure to give credit for suggestions. There's nothing that makes a person feel any better than to be recognized for giving a suggestion that is put into practice. It would be an injustice for a leader to ask for suggestions and then to find a good suggestion on the part of the worker and then not give the proper credit to that individual. A second thing which would certainly create not only unrest, it would create low morale in the company or organization, and that would be when complaints are brought or grievances and nothing is done. And then, of course, the failure to encourage. Again, everybody needs encouragement. Everybody needs uplifting and upbuilding. And nobody, not even children, want to be criticized in front of other people. Nobody wants to be belittled in front of others. Wives don't want their husbands to belittle them or to criticize them in front of others. Neither do employees want leaders, supervisors, or employers to criticize them in front of their peers. If there's something that needs to be dealt with, it should always be done in private. Then the fifth, failure to ask employees their opinions. Now, what do we say concerning the setting of goals? That if you have people involved in the agenda of setting goals, you're going to get more cooperation from them. They're going to be more likely to support your vision. Failure to inform employees of their progress. I think that's a principle that is true in school, in the classroom. Everybody wants to know how they're progressing toward their goal. And then favoritism. This is something, first of all, the Bible says that God is no respecter of persons. Children don't like parents who show favoritism toward siblings, other children. Students in school do not like for teachers to play favorites. Same thing is true on the job. Everybody feels like that they are just as important as someone else and they deserve the recognition and the credit that others receive. Then our final principle for this particular lesson on people development. The greatest potential for growth of a company or an organization is the growth of its people. It doesn't make any difference what the nature of the organization is. It makes no difference what the product is. People development is important. The growth of people is important. Therefore, it is important for leaders to be aware of the fact that people need opportunity to grow. They need to be presented with opportunity to expand themselves. Okay, I think that will pretty much conclude our section on people development. Now let's move on into our seventh principle of leadership. Now, where have we been so far? What are the principles that we have dealt with? We've dealt with the principle of influence. We've dealt with the principle of priorities, the principle of integrity, the principle of positive change, creating positive change, the principle of problem solving, the principle of attitude, the principle of people development, and now we're going to be taking a look at what is considered an indispensable quality of leadership, and that's vision. We're going to be looking at the principle of vision. All effective leaders have vision. Vision is something that is possible. Vision is potential. Vision is something that may yet be futuristic. It's a goal. It's a dream. It's something that one reaches out for. Every effective leader has a vision of what can be accomplished. With that vision, the leader is on a mission, and a contagious spirit is felt among the crowd until others begin to rise alongside of the leader. The result of vision is purpose. We could say that without a vision, the people perish. That's what the scripture says. Without purpose, people are directionless. Helen Keller, of course, who was blind as well as deaf, was asked the question, "What do you believe would be worse than being born blind?" She replied, "To have sight without vision." All great leaders possess two things. Number one, they know where they're going, and they're able to persuade others to follow them. They know where they're going, they have vision, and they're able to sell that vision. They have direction, they have purpose, and they're able to persuade or to convince others to follow them. And of course, if you don't have others following you, you're not a leader. As John Maxwell says, you're just simply taking a walk. It's also important to articulate our vision. If an organization has a purpose or a vision, it's important for you to be able to verbalize that purpose. It's important for you to be able to state your mission. There are two primary reasons for developing a purpose for your organization. Number one is that it becomes a rallying cry. Motivation or inspiration. It's that slogan, it's that cliche that rallies the forces. And then, of course, the second is that vision becomes the control tool, which actually, and when we talk about vision, we're talking about the statement of purpose. It becomes the tool by which that a person is able to have the guidelines to determine whether that they're reaching their goal. What you see is what you can be. If you can't see something, chances are you will not become that. Things don't just happen accidentally. Some people seem to think that things happen because you are in the right place at the right time, or some people attribute success to luck. But 90 statistics would be, but I would say that probably 95% of success has been planned on. It's a goal that has been set and an effort has been made to obtain that goal. In fact, Stanford research says that 89% of what we learn is visual, 10% of what we learn is auditory, and 1% is what we learn through other senses. There are four levels of vision, four vision levels of people. There are some who have no vision at all. They never see what's out there. They're just wandering stars. Then there are those who see it, but they don't pursue it. These are followers. And then there are those who see it and pursue it. These are achievers. But those who see it, pursue it, and help others to see it are leaders. Again, we see what we're prepared to see. Isn't it amazing that you may not be aware of, say, a particular model of an automobile until you have either purchased one yourself and then you start seeing them show up everywhere. Why? Because we see what we're prepared to see. Konrad Adenauer, who was the Chancellor of Germany, as I recall, West Germany, said, "We all live under the same sky, but we don't all have the same horizon." Why is it that you can have people sitting side by side, living under the same sky, but not have the same vision? The same thing is true of a family. You can take children in a family, children brought up in the same household, and they're going to be invariably there's going to be one, at least one, who's going to have a vision that's going to go far beyond that which the rest of the family possesses. Henry Ford was a dreamer. Henry Ford was a man of vision. Henry Ford was a man who would not take no for an answer. He would not take the reports of the engineers who would say things like, "Well, this is an impossibility. The V8 automobile engine was invented by Ford Motor Company." Henry Ford had the vision of this V8 motor. He went to his engineers and they came to the conclusion that it could not be done. He said, "Produce it anyway." They replied, "But it's impossible." "Go ahead," Ford commanded, "and stay on the job until you succeed, no matter how much time is required." Well, 6 months passed, nothing happened. Another 6 months, nothing. At the end of the year, Ford checked with his engineers, and once again they told him that what he wanted was impossible. Ford told them, "Keep going." They did, and finally, they discovered a way of building a V8 engine. Well, here's an example of Henry Ford being under the same sky as the engineers, but they did not have the same horizon. They did not have the same vision. There was a bishop who went to pay a visit to a small Midwestern religious college. He stayed at the home of the college president. After dinner, the bishop declared that the millennium couldn't be far off. And his reasoning was because everything about nature had been discovered and all inventions conceived. Well, this young college president disagreed politely, and he said he felt that there would be many more discoveries. And the bishop was angered. He asked the president to name one such invention. The president replied that he was certain that within 50 years, men would be able to fly. The bishop declared, "Nonsense. Only angels are intended to fly." Well, that bishop's name was right. He had two sons at home who would prove him wrong, Orville and Wilbur Wright. Here was a father who lived under the same sky as his two sons, but they did not have the same horizon. So what you see is what you get. You have to see it before it's accomplished. Robert Woodruff was the president of Coca-Cola from 1923 to 1955. He boldly declared, "We will see that every man in uniform gets a bottle of Coca-Cola for 5 cents wherever he is and whatever the cost." When World War II had ended, Woodruff stated that before he died, he wanted every person in the world to have tasted Coca-Cola. That's what you call a man of vision. Coca-Cola has circled the world and is probably the most universal product on the globe today. It's a well-known story about the opening of the Walt Disney World. Mrs. Disney was asked to speak at the grand opening. She was introduced by a man who said, "Mrs. Disney, I just wish Walt could have seen this." She stood up and said, he did and sat down. The truth is, if Walt Disney had not seen Disney World would not have been there. Bob Beale said, keep in mind the difference between a winner's and a loser's mentality. Winners don't just focus on winning, they focus on winning big. Losers don't necessarily focus on losing, they just focus on getting by. A person who just has a mentality of getting by could really be classified as a loser. There are some people who have the mentality of just making it, or there's also a mentality in athletics that oftentimes can lead to defeat, and that is looking for ways to keep from losing. In other words, a basketball team can be very aggressive. A basketball team can go on the offense and score a lot of points and maybe get a lead, and then they fall back into the mentality of trying to protect that lead instead of keep pushing on with that killer instinct. They begin to say, let's just don't lose this game. They lose focus on pursuing the margin of victory, and as a result, oftentimes the game will slip through their grasp. If you had anything you wanted, unlimited time, unlimited money, unlimited information, unlimited staff, all the resources you could ask for, what would you do? Let me repeat that. Ask yourself this question. If money were not an issue, if time were not an issue, all the resources were there, what would you do? What would be your goal? That would be your vision. Rick Warren said, if you want to know the temperature of your organization, put a thermometer in the leader's mouth. If you want to find where an organization is, check the leader. Leaders can never take people further than they themselves are willing to go or have traveled. One thing that we also want to remember is that people usually don't follow a vision. People don't buy into a vision. People buy into a man. People buy into a leader. A leader who has a vision must sell himself. It's not the matter of convincing others to buy into the vision. It's a matter of getting others to trust you. They don't buy the vision. They don't pursue the vision. They pursue the man. One of the things that we can do, of course, as a leader of vision, is to take a look within. What do you feel? Theodore Herzberg said, the very essence of leadership is that you have a vision. It's a vision that must be articulated clearly and forcefully on every occasion. In other words, if you're not burning with this enthusiasm and this zeal, if you're not able to articulate this vision, then it's probably a very weak vision. And this is what we refer to as an uncertain trumpet. Now, a person who cannot speak out confidently and articulate clearly his vision is either very limited or lacks in his vision, or he is trying to live someone else's dream. Many great people who began life begin in the poorest and most humble of homes with little education or no advantages. I've heard Bishop Huskins tell the story about how he, as a small boy, would take his little sister out on the creek that flowed by his home over in White, Georgia, and would wonder in his mind, now, where does this creek go? Surely there is another world outside of White, Georgia. Surely there are horizons that are beyond this limited surrounding, this limited environment that I'm a part of. Bishop Huskins is a man of vision. And many people who have been the most successful in life and who have become the most effective leaders have been those who have transcended their limitations. Thomas Edison was a newsboy on a train. Andrew Carnegie started working at $4 a month. John D. Rockefeller started working at $6 a week. Others who were handicapped. Demosthenes, the greatest orator of the ancient world, stuttered. The first time he tried to make a public speech, he was laughed off the rostrum. Julius Caesar was an epileptic. Napoleon was of a humble parentage and far from being born a genius. In fact, in his military class of 65, he finished 46th. Beethoven was deaf. So was Thomas Edison. Charles Dickens was lame. So was Handel. Homer was blind. Plato was a hunchback. Sir Walter Scott was paralyzed, but they were not limited by their circumstances. They had a vision that transcended their surroundings and their circumstances. Each of these men had a fire on the inside that could not be extinguished. So, in becoming an effective leader, first of all, we said, look within. A second consideration, look behind you. What have you learned? What has history taught you? What are your experiences? Now, if a person has a vision without experience, then perhaps their vision is idealistic. But a person with experience learns that people buy into the leader before they buy into the vision. Let me share some principles of vision. The credibility of a vision is determined by the leader. The credibility of the vision. The acceptance of a vision is determined by the timing of his presentation. You can have a vision, and of course our goal as a leader is to be able to sell that vision or to get support for that vision. We want to influence others to pursue our vision, to help us to obtain our vision. Oftentimes, the acceptance or non-acceptance of a vision has to do with timing. The value of a vision is determined by the energy and direction it gives. And of course, one of the considerations in selling a vision to others, and as we said, really we're selling ourselves, but we have to come across as being believable. People have to have confidence in you. They have to have trust. And one of the things that we have to keep in mind is that everybody essentially are asking the question, what's in this for me? What energy and direction is this vision going to give? And then you can evaluate the vision by checking the commitment level of the people. If the people aren't committed to a vision, then you have, first of all, it may not be a credible vision, or the timing may be wrong, or you haven't been able to sell the value of the vision. And so the bottom line is that the evaluation of a vision is based on the commitment level of the people. And then, of course, the ultimate success of the vision is going to be determined by how much the people, that you're seeking to follow you can claim ownership to the vision. Okay, so first we look within, we look behind us. What have we learned? What are our experiences? Third, look around you. What is happening to others? A little boy goes to his first symphonic concert. He was excited about the experience. A beautiful building, beautiful people, people dressed out, enthusiasm. All the instruments in the orchestra were fine-tuned, but there was one instrument in the orchestra that drew his attention, and that was the cymbals. The first loud, dramatic crash of those brass discs won him over without reservation. But he noticed, for most of the evening, the man who had the cymbals was just standing motionless while the other musicians played. And occasionally, the cymbal player was called upon to make his contribution, even though that his time in the sun and his time of glory was very brief. After the concert, the little boy's parents took him backstage to meet some of the musicians. Immediately, the little boy sought out the cymbalist. "Say, mister," he said sincerely, "how much do you need to know to play the cymbals?" The musician laughed and answered, "You don't have to know much at all. You only need to know when." So it's not so much what as it is when. So again, timing is important. A good idea becomes great when people are ready to accept it. And of course, the evidence of strength lies in the leader who is able to know where people are and not to get too far ahead of people. It's important for a leader to be versatile enough to be able to be far enough out front to lead people, to set the pace, but not to be so out front and to run too far ahead, or else we lose our power to influence. Okay, so we look within, we look behind us, we look around us, and now we look ahead of us. By looking ahead,